Okay, guys, let's talk a bit more about what we can do with arrays and lists. So first of all, as you've seen in the previous lecture, we can use arrayOf to create a new array. And if we use this function, we can actually create mixed arrays. So we can put in different types in here. So we can have a string like colon, we can have numbers, 17, or doubles, or a boolean. Anything we like, basically, and we can just mix them in one and the same array. Now, if you don't really need this, you can make sure that the array only contains elements of the type you want by using another function that Kotlin offers you. And for numbers, we can use something like int_arrayOf, for example. And similarly, there's also double_arrayOf and so on. So let's create an int array for now. And creative as I am, I'm just gonna say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 again. So this array can now only contain integers, so that you can be sure there are only integers in there at any given time. Now we can access each of these individual elements inside the array by using square brackets. And in programming, we always begin counting at 0. So to get the first element inside our array mixed, we have to actually specify a 0 in here, which is going to give us Kotlin in this case. We can quickly test that by printing out this first element inside our array. So if we run this, we're going to see that it gives us Kotlin as we expected. And we can actually also use this to reassign the elements inside our array. So let's say we want to change 3.0. So to do that, we would have to write mixed, and inside these square brackets, we use 2 because we want our third element. And now we can set it to our new number, like for example 3.1415. And this is going to reassign our third element inside the array. So if we print this out, this is going to give us 3.1415. And just a quick note, what this does internally is it actually calls these get and set methods. You could also use them explicitly, but you can also use the notation with these square brackets. And another thing I'd like to mention is that strings can also be treated like arrays. So if I create a new string, let's say str equals Udemy, then what we can actually do is we can print out string at position 1, let's say. So our string is basically an array of characters, with U being the first one, D being the second one, and so on. So let's run this quickly, and we're going to see that it prints the first character inside our string. So sometimes it may be useful for you to remember that you can actually treat strings as arrays of characters. Now, what if we want to create an array that contains all the elements from two other arrays? So we want to basically concatenate two arrays. Well, we can do that really easily in Kotlin, but we have to have two arrays of the same type. So I'm just going to create a new array which contains some more states, let's say. And if I want to concatenate this with my array up here, and then what I can do is I can simply write array plus states, and that's going to concatenate my two arrays. So this is going to give me an array that contains all elements from both my arrays. Alright, so that's how you can combine two arrays into one. Now next, what's really important and what you will use fairly often is to get the size of an array. So you want to know how many elements are there in this array. And that's also fairly simple. So what you can do is you can print, for example, allStates.size. And .size is going to give you the number of elements in your array. So if we print this, this is going to give us 5 in this case, because we had an array of 3 elements and we concatenated 2 more elements. Another really useful function is the isEmpty function, which is going to tell us if an array is, well, empty. So we could do something like numbers.isEmpty, and this is going to give us a boolean variable. So I could also store this in a value, let's say, of type boolean. And that's gonna be fine. And of course, in this case, this will return false because my numbers array has 5 elements and is therefore not empty. Now, the last function I'd like to talk about in this lecture is called contains, and it tells us if our array contains a certain element we can specify. So let's say we want to know if our states array contains the state Kentucky. And let's wrap this right into an if statement. So if states.contains Kentucky, then we want to do something like print line it contains Kentucky, and else we're gonna print line it does not. And if you run this, in this case, this is of course gonna print out it does not, because nowhere did I add Kentucky as a state. Okay, so those are the most important basic functions you can use with arrays. And we're gonna talk about a lot more things you can do with arrays when we talk about loops, and also when we talk about functional concepts. Because for arrays and lists in particular, there are lots of powerful functional features we can use. So that, for example, we can easily change every element inside the array in a certain way in just one line. But that's gonna be part of a later lecture. So for now, just try these out for yourself, and I'll see you in the next lecture. Thanks so much for watching. If you've learned something new in this video, please make sure to give it a like. And also, if you're new here, hit the subscribe button and the bell icon to be notified of any new tutorials. If you want to watch more, check over here, and I will see you in the next video.